Community TV honors and acknowledges that we create video content on Treaty 7, Treaty 4 territories, traditional lands of the Siksika, Kainai, Piikani, Stoney Nakoda, Tsuut'ina, Cree, Sioux, and Saltino bands of the Ojibwe peoples. We also acknowledge that we are on Métis Nation Region 3. This content is created with the help of fans and local businesses that sponsor the content. Sponsors don't necessarily endorse all of the content, they support your access to relevant news and stories.
I have to ask, and I don't know if anybody has any info, it sort of seems like it's been up in the air, but if anybody would know, I think maybe you would know, do you know what's going on with the Monarch?
Oh, the Monarch Theatre, I believe April 11th, which is today, is the deadline. They're supposed to be picking somebody. I heard there were 10 groups.
Mm-hmm.
I know a couple of the groups.
Yep.
I'm on the Friends of the Monarch.
I know.
Some of the people have asked if we would help them out if they decide to buy it.
Yep.
And there are people out there that want to lease it, mm-hmm. and people that want to buy it. But I think the bottom line is everybody would like to keep it a theater, but add more to it.
Yes.
We just didn't have enough going on before.
That's absolutely it.
It would sit empty for days and days and, yeah.
I hate to get back on the CCDA stuff, but it was like they thought that the Monarch was just going to mushroom into this great thing that, but I mean, you need to feed your plants for them to grow,
yeah,
you know?
Right.
And yeah, I think it's absolutely true that we have this amazing space. We just got to figure out what it is that we do there. And there's a lot of different ideas.
You're right, Tom.
I liked some of the ideas and I had input. I gave some, everybody who's asked me, I've always said, you know, and coming back to the whole things are expensive. Video games are really expensive nowadays. I mean, they always have been a middle class sort of thing to own, the newest one, but it's becoming more and more of an unobtainable thing when the newest video game costs $80 and then you have to subscribe on the internet for $80 a month to play it, and then if you want to get the latest gun you have to get your mom's credit card for another $25.
Just
it costs so much. And what I've always thought is, wouldn't it be nice if there was a hub where when the new game comes out, every kid could come down, every adult, everybody who likes games could come down and try it.
Yeah.
Wouldn't it be cool if we just got the newest game, put it on the screen at the Monarch, and then handed around the controllers for a couple hours for people to learn and play the new game? I've always thought that that would be so cool, and I think that whatever happens with whoever the new people are, I'm gonna bring them a PlayStation, and I'm gonna say, what do you think?
Tom, I'm hoping somebody buys it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is my opinion. If you lease it, the city will still own it. It's not going to be any different than it was before. Somebody has to buy it where they're going to put their sweat and tears in it.
Yep.
They're going to come up with some great ideas. I don't know if leasing it and having another board run it, everybody has their own opinion.
Mm-hmm.
It takes forever to make a decision.
Mm-hmm.
You go to a board meeting and I think we should do this, 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 and somebody's got this idea, somebody's got that idea. Okay, let's table it till our next meeting.
True.
And you go nowhere.
Yep.
I would like to see somebody apply to buy it so they put their money in it and they will work twice as hard to get money back. And I want them to come up with new ideas.
Mm-hmm.
If it is just a board, again, and just leasing it, you can sit on it for so long, but you get somebody in there that's going to really convince you to sell it to them and give all the ideas they want to do with it, because you can do so much.
Mm-hmm.
You can have plays and you can have movies and you can have exactly that. I know some man that would love to have some of the playoff hockey games on that big screen.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then all these ideas used to come in, but the answer was always no, no, no. Let's have matinees for kids. No, you just need somebody that's gonna
pull the trigger.
Yeah,
yep.
Do it seriously.
Yeah.
I just hope it's not a board.
There's always been this sort of, I think people picture it like, if it's a not-for-profit, if it's a board, then it can do wonderful things for the community. If it's a business, then it will earn profit for one guy. But the reality is, businesses that earn profit for the owner of the business can also have great impacts on the community and do brilliant things. So there are sometimes, I guess what you'd call like a social enterprise style business, where the guy who's running it probably isn't running it because he thinks he's going to get rich.
Right.
It's because we have to preserve that place and you need money to do that.
Yeah.
So you've got to have somebody there who says, I'm not going to lose my house and my shirt doing this. You're right, when it's a board, what do they got to lose?
That's right.
In fact, win or lose, they all kind of seem to walk away successful, you know?
Well, and you know, sometimes it's too easy just to say, well, I can't go to the board meeting tonight and I'm going to step down from the board. I just think they need some entrepreneur with some great plans, and they can still have a board just to give them some advice, you know, and they would need help running it. But there's so much you can do with it. And it was just getting around, starting to, you know, come out in the black. It was just starting to work.
Yep.
And then it's been shut down. And now it should have opened a year ago.
Right.
But it's been shut down, and it's too bad.
The Friends of the Monarch basically is a not-for-profit that was created independently of the Monarch, strictly to raise money.
Right.
Whatever happens to the Monarch.
Yeah.
It's like you guys are like the lifeguards of the Monarch. Like, don't let it sink. Nope, we're going to keep it above water. Here's another buoy if you need it.
Yeah. Well, and the Friends of the Monarch would still help anybody that did buy it. We would still help with fundraisers, help.
Now, if somebody buys it and they change the name of it from the Monarch to something else, do you have to change your name to the Friends of the something else?
Yeah, the Friends of the something. I don't know, and I suppose it is up to them if they want to change it.
Yeah.
It's so well known for the Monarch. It
truly is.
I don't know.
I love the name, the Monarch. I mean, we have Monarch butterflies in this area.
Yeah.
We naturally grow the plants that attract Monarch butterflies. I think the Monarch is great.
Yeah.
Leave it. But, you know, if you're going to change it, there should be a minimum. $1 million or something like that for the naming rights. Let's see. What else would I have on here? And a half, and worked with those folks. They were just making decisions and doing things. They weren't, you know, muddling over who and when and how. They were just, we're going to paint the wall. Get an artist, get some paint. Let's get the paint. Let's paint the wall. Like, we're doing it now.
Tom, and that's how our board... For we have a group for Alive After Five, because I didn't want to put it on by myself. So we have
which would be impossible.
Yeah. Well, and I have the last 5-6 years, I was just doing it myself.
No way.
Yeah, so it was a lot of work.
Then
there were some steady retailers that would come every week, and I got to know them, like Stephen and Robin, and I got to know them. So when we thought of resurrecting Alive After Five, I contacted those people. They said, sure, I'll do it. And now when we have a meeting, everybody's gung-ho. They're doing this, they're doing that.
Right.
They're doing the donations, they're in charge of that. And they're so keen. So that's what's exciting about it.
And that's what I think about the Monarch. It's going to depend. If you can find a board of people who are all strictly interested in success, first of all, and success meaning you've got to pay the bills.
Yeah.
Because it's not going to be the Friends of the Monarch pulling up your pants every month.
Yeah.
You know, so we've got to find a group of people that want to figure out how to make it make money.
Yeah, and you know, you can go to other cities. When just before we did some of the promotions for the Monarch Theatre, we would drive to Moose Jaw. I'd go to Moose Jaw and see their older theatre, and you see everything they're doing. You go online, you find out what other theatres are doing.
Yep.
So you're not stuck in the same
And then do it. Don't just talk about doing it. Like, we could talk about film festivals for, you know, until we're blue in the face. Let's just say we are having a film festival. Anybody out there who's got a camera and an idea, make something that's 15 minutes long or a half hour long.
Yeah.
We'll have a group vet them, and then we'll have a film festival in Medicine Hat. Because, I mean, I know this college is producing, not that the college is producing them. There are brilliant artists who happen to go to our college here. Some of them live here and will stay here. And yeah, there's a ton of talent that could be.
Yeah.
Quick shout out to the sponsors like 24/7 Rideshare. Download the app. You can get a ride. It's just like Uber in Medicine Hat. Our local Gas King. Earn and save 6 cents per liter with your King card. The fabulous and wonderful Cliff Restaurant in the beautiful Clarion Point Hotel.
So what do I think? I think I don't really care whether or not it's somebody who owns it and is making money. If I had the money and I thought, you know, if I thought I had that time and that money, I would have put my name on and said,
You better get your application in today.
Yeah, I don't think financially it's something that I am capable of doing right now. You know what I mean? Like, I don't even have my first house paid off. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know if I want to put all of my eggs into that basket, but I'm sure there's somebody else out there who's business-minded, who has plenty more eggs than I have and can put a few into that basket and then hire some people that are going to make that work. Yeah, I it probably would be more successful as a private company.
And that's my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, when I wanted to help advertise for the Monarch years ago, even just under the capacity of I'll do it for free.
Yes.
And it was hard to do because there were some people on the board that just, man, I don't really like him, so I'm going to try and make this harder. And it's like, why? This is about the monarch. This isn't about how you feel or your ego or their feelings or, you know, it's about the building and the idea and the thing. So, yeah, I've been in love with it ever since I went in it. I mean, the monarch it's one of the best buildings that we have downtown, period. I mean, I remember taking the tour all through it when the CCDA said, yeah, we can let the community TV guys shoot some videos. And then I walked all through it with Colin, of course, but I didn't forget Colin. The building itself is like, I mean, you can't get rid of it. It's too unique. It's
unique, and it shouldn't be sitting empty.
It shouldn't be sitting empty. I mean, that's something that I discussed with Shyla, you know, months ago when we first did our meeting right after the CCDA had disbanded and closed it. And it's like, if it sits empty any longer, it's going to cost just to clean it up and get it back into shape. Like, using something regularly is kind of what keeps it good, you know?
Tom, you should see the down. You were in the basement then. Mm-hmm. You know, the dirt floor.
Well,
gotta be hunched
dirt
over.
Dirt floor, it had, as I remember, the poster from Alice in Wonderland or something. Like, it was like a poster from like 60 years ago on the dirt floor so that you didn't get your shoes too dirty.
I know, but you could give tours easily down there. Make a few dollars, a toonie, a tour.
Ghost tours.
Yes.
Somebody makes a woo noise from the furnace room.
Yeah, I think there's a lot you could do. So I really hope somebody with great ideas and flexible with what they want to do, I hope they get the board.
Yeah, fingers crossed. Well, we'll find out tonight, and then I guess we're going to be celebrating soon.
Yeah.
Whoever gets it better have a big party and invite in the Friends of the Monarch
and some
other user groups and people that will help promote. And
when we first opened the Monarch Theatre, we had Titanic.
Oh, yeah.
And that was good. We sold out.
Yeah.
And everybody was all dressed up. And you got a card, so you knew who you were on the Titanic. And then at the end, you found out as you were leaving that night whether you lived or died. That was good.
The one that I remember the most vividly was, I think it was Van Gogh. The painted frame-by-frame movie. Was it Van Gogh? It was called? It was like the life and times of Van Gogh.
Okay.
And then it was like, the way that they had produced the film was they had filmed it, and then they took every slide of the film and painted it, and then replayed the film as a painting.
Okay.
Mesmerizing.
Wow.
And I remember seeing it there, and I remember the place being full, and people leaving talking about it, and it's a different experience when you see something at a small community theater that maybe you would never even be able to see anywhere else. Then if you go to IMAX, like going to IMAX, you know everybody else in the world had that same X-Men movie experience, whatever. It's not, okay, I'm excited, whatever. But when you see something that's like a hidden gem that nobody else gets to see at a small local theater, you're like, that was priceless.
Yeah.
Like, nobody else gets to see that, so
yeah.
It'll remain priceless in my mind, and I'll continue to support it. I mean, I'm behind it just the same way the Friends of the Monarch.
Yeah.
I mean, even if it is a company that takes it over and, you know, they're a startup, I'm going to give them their first ad for free or, you know what I mean? I want to help promote them, whatever it is, because it's, for me, it's, I don't really care about the money, all that stuff about it. I care more about people having access to the place and being able to do things there.
Did we get any proposals from people outside the city to buy the Monarch? Do you know?
I didn't look at all the proposals. I knew
Some are numbered companies.
Yeah.
Thank you. I'll just put it on the floor. So it's like, thank you. And I'll be
Thanks so much.
For it in a minute.
Do you want me to bring the machine over here?
Totally.
Okay.
That's fine.
Oh,
convenient.
Mind.
Yeah.
I buy my pet food from Rob at Animal World. 616 has virtual reality and axe throwing and a whole bunch of other cool stuff. 616 Entertainment in downtown Medicine Hat.
Oh, you know what? I'm paying cash. Sorry.
Oh, cash?
Just
bring
me the bill. Thanks.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, there's some numbered companies, so you don't know who they
are. I don't know who all of them are. I mean, for me, it was like, sure, I could invest my time in looking at which ones I like or which ones I think are good ideas, but in the end, it's somebody else's decision. So I'll just kind of wait for the decision, and then, you know, we'll see how we work with that. You know, because in a bid like this, there's not much even a media person, even if I had, you know, a reach of every single person in Medicine Hat, I can tell them about it. Can I? I think probably telling them that it was available influenced some of these groups that actually put the bids in. And I know a few people that, that have contacted me with, you know, questions, suggestions, what do you think I should do, and this and that. And I just told them what I told you. I think you should have more events there, do more stuff. You know, like the Oxford Theatre in Halifax, one of the things that they were really well known for was having, during the summer, they'd do midnight movies, which were horror films and stuff like that. So, you know, there's horror movie buffs that maybe want to watch, you know, a slasher movie from the 60s or 70s or something like that. But it's a little more fun to do at midnight when you know the only people who are going to go out to that movie are other weirdos like you, you know? So maybe before the theater opens, you're in the alleyway out back with your friends, you know?
Here you are.
Oh, thank you very much.
Yeah, no problem.
Thanks so much.
Thanks.
Yeah, so I think, yeah, just more events and more different stuff. I think there's so many things that could be done there.
Yeah.
I mean, and not even just movie, video game, theater related. I think to myself, there are, you know, maybe groups that want to just have, want to do a presentation in a nice little place, and they don't want to spend a ton of money to do it, because it costs a lot of money to rent out a hotel, banquet hall, or whatever it might be, you know. If I wanted to do
Or more weddings.
Yeah, weddings,
weddings, anniversaries.
I emceed a wedding at the Monarch Theatre years ago.
Oh, yeah?
Remember when I did roller derby? I was the announcer at the roller derby thing. There was a couple of girls that were in roller derby that were getting married, and they said, our budget is, like, super thin. Like, we're getting the Monarch, we're gonna do it all there, and then, you know, that's it. We need somebody to kind of just host the thing on the microphone to say what's happening next or whatever. And I'm like, okay, not only have I never emceed a wedding, I have only ever been to two weddings. Okay, like I'm not a pro at this, and I don't know how you become a pro. And they said, well, you know, will you come? And I was like, yeah, of course I'll come. Like, I mean, I'm honored that you invite me to your wedding or whatever, right? And it was actually...
Did it turn out nice?
It turned out awesome. I mean, it was like, that theater, it can hold a certain kind of energy in it that you can't really explain. Like, I mean, if you got married in an IMAX, I don't know, right? I mean, but it was like, just the, maybe it's a design person's mind.
Yeah.
When I look at something and it's got, you know, wood grain stage, and that wood clearly has been stepped on over like 100 years, and you just know that there's something about the object, the building, the wood, the stage, the chairs, they hold this energy that you can't quite just quantify.
Yeah,
you know, it's not...
Nice. Well, and I'm hoping too, whoever buys Monarch, that after Alive After Five is on 5 till 8, that they would have a movie at 8 or 8:15.
Yep.
So
integrate.
That anybody's still downtown, just go over to the movies, you know?
Yeah, synergize together a way that there's... It's like the pathway of downtown.
Yes.
Instead of just... Oh, I came downtown because I wanted to do this one thing, and oh my God, I can't believe I couldn't park right in front of it.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, how about we think about downtown like an experience where you can actually go do a few things.
Yes.
It's totally okay to park somewhere, have a meal, go see a live artist perform, and then go to a movie. And
maybe some of the stakeholders would say, every Wednesday night at Live After Five, we're open till 8.
Yeah.
You know, so people
or
can
nine
get
even,
easy.
Or I mean,
yeah.
In the summertime, sometimes it feels like it's still light out around 8 o'clock and businesses are closing.
Yeah. That's one thing I used to hear from people. They would come to the park and say, you know what, I thought I'd do some shopping down here tonight and everything, and everybody's closed at 5.
Right.
So if some of the stakeholders would stay open, it would just be a great evening.
It's almost like there's got to be a little bit of a cooperation. And I feel like that in the past, everybody was just like, oh, the CCDA is supposed to just tell us what to do. Or somebody else is our boss to tell us what to do.
Now they get to do what they want.
Yeah, you get to do whatever you want. And really, if what you want is to talk to a few other businesses and say, hey, neighbors, let's stay open just on this. Let's just give it a try on Wednesday and just see what happens. Who knows?
Yeah.
Could be a successful thing.
Because whatever happens, whatever stores want to stay open, we would add that to our advertising.
Truckers, 24/7 restaurant next to the gas station on the right-hand side of the #1 highway as you come into Medicine Hat from Red Cliff. Truckers is a home-cooked meal and a very popular stop for cross-country truckers. Check Skip the Dishes for Truckers tonight. Do you need a lawyer? Call 403-527-3030, the law office of Yarshenko and Heidinger. If you've been charged with a criminal or regulatory offense, the law office of Yarshenko and Heidinger has experience, skill, and the demonstrated track record to professionally and ably guide you through the legal process. If you've been charged with a criminal offense, the law office of Yarshenko and Heidinger wants to represent you. Call for a consultation, 403-527-3030. That's 403-527-3030. Call my lawyer, 403-527-3030. Community TV is only possible with fan subscriptions from fans like you and sponsorships from local businesses. Sponsoring this community TV content is a great way to show community engagement and an inexpensive way to advertise your brand. Thank you very much for watching community TV. Right now, until the end of the year, I'm having a big push for fan subscriptions on the Facebook page. If we reach 500 fan subscribers, I will make a $1,000 donation to the charity of your choosing. We have 15,000 followers now, so that's only 3.4%. Just buy me coffee once a month, and we can improve the quality and delivery of local stories. As a fan subscriber to Community TV, you'll also receive exclusive content, access to live videos, and entries into the 15,000 fan giveaway, which is going to include lots of great local prizes.